Hello, my name is George Stack and I'm the Archbishop of Cardiff. But since Bishop Tom Burns retired as Bishop of Menevia here in Swansea, I've been looking after this diocese too. And over the last year or so, I've got to know all of the churches and many of the schools, including, of course, Bishop Vaughan School. I'm standing in St. Joseph's Cathedral in Swansea, and I know this is where you normally have your Christmas carol service, but the COVID crisis has prevented the school from getting together as you would like at this time of the year. I'm here this morning not just to join you in this recording, but later on we're going to have the celebration of the 50th anniversary of the ordination of Bishop Tom Burns to the priesthood. So the cathedral will be full, although socially distanced, and we'll have a wonderful celebration. I know that Bishop Tom is very fond of Bishop Vaughan School, and he spoke to me often about it. So when I said that I was coming here this morning to be with you for your carol service, he asked that I would give you his very best wishes for Christmas and for the coming year. I mentioned a moment ago that you couldn't all join together because of the crisis, which is COVID pandemic. But of course, there are always crises going on in our world and in our lives. Crisis means two different things. It can mean devastation. It can also mean opportunity. And it seems to me that as another year comes to an end, and even though we're faced with the challenge of COVID, and you're faced with knowing how best to organize your studies, you will be helped by the teachers at Bishop Vaughan to organize yourselves in ways that perhaps we'd never thought of before. A great opportunity. During the Christmas season, we remember the events surrounding the birth of Jesus Christ. And in their own way, these were crises too. Mary and Joseph had to travel from Nazareth in the north of Israel down to Bethlehem for the census. We're familiar with the story. When they arrived at Bethlehem, no room for them at the inn, and so they were obliged to go to the stable where the miraculous birth of Jesus, the Son of God, took place. It's amazing, isn't it, that Mary and Joseph and the Christmas story can speak to us of all those who are dispossessed, who are homeless, who are refugees even, because Mary and Joseph, as the Gospel tells us, had to escape from Israel, from Bethlehem, from Nazareth, because King Herod was scared that this child who had been foretold would undermine his kingdom. And so they had to join the refugee trail and go down into Egypt until King Herod was dead. All of these things are wrapped up in the Christmas story and speak to us of the various challenges that we have to face in our own lives. During this season, we look back at the historical event of the birth of Jesus in Nazareth 2,000 years ago. We look forward to the second coming of Jesus at the end of time. But for me, one of the most important messages of Christmas, and indeed the whole of our lives, is that the end of time is now. Every moment of every day is the end of that time. So it's for you and I to seize the moment, carpe diem, and make the most of our time, and ensure that our time is well used and is blessed and is fruitful, so that we in our turn can be a source of blessing and fruitfulness and joy to the people with whom we live, we study, we work, and we play. So let's begin listening once again to the beautiful message of Christmas unfolded in our carols, in our readings, and in our prayers.
It was the woman you put here with me, the man said. She gave me some of the fruit and I ate it. The Lord God then asked the woman, what have you done? The snake tricked me, she answered, and I ate some of that fruit. So the Lord God said to the snake, because of what you have done, you will be the only animal to suffer this curse. For as long as you will live, you will crawl on your stomach and eat dirt. You and this woman will hate each other. Your descendants and hers will always be enemies. One of hers will strike you on the head, and you will strike him on the heel.
Oh, Second lesson. God promises to the faithful Abraham that in his seed shall the nations of the earth be blessed. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as grains of sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring all nations on earth will be blessed, because you have obeyed me.
Christ's birth and kingdom are foretold. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood would be destined to burn, would be fueled with the flame. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Thank you.
Fourth lesson, the peace that Christ will bring is for Shem. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, or decide by what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decision for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. The wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear. The young will lay down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play me in a cobra's den. The young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea.
Virgin Mary. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name is Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words, and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end. How would this be? Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin. The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she, who was said to be unable to conceive, is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail.
Issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in the manger, because there was no guest room available to them.
Ding dong! the shepherds go to the manger, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I will bring you good news, and this will cause great joy for all your people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This is a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger."
When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Thank you. Ninth lesson. St. John unfolds the great mystery of the Incarnation. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light, he came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet all those who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, or of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Blessings
of the season be upon you. Thank you for sharing in our Christmas carol service.
Oh,
our carols and said our prayers and reflected on the beautiful readings of the Christmas story, it's time for us to give thanks to God for all that we have received in our families, in our homes, from our friends, in our schools. Gifts of God, as we are to each other. We give thanks that Jesus came in history 2,000 years ago. We look forward to his coming at the end of time. But we profess our faith that the end of time is now. And we pray that this Christmas will be a time of happiness and joy and recreation and peace for you and all your families. And so bow down your heads and pray for God's blessing. May the peace of Christ reign in your homes and in your hearts. May you be a source of blessing to all with whom you come in contact during this season of Christmas. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down upon you and those you love, today and forevermore. Amen.